Hello everyone, welcome back to another differential equations video. This time I'll be solving a problem. A homogeneous system of differential equations. So, firstly, let's just write the system. Dx dt. Why is this so difficult? Okay, there we go. That equals 3x minus y dy dt. That equals 9x minus 3y. Now, we will be converting this into matrix form, which is this. We have 3, the coefficients basically of the variables, negative 1, 9, negative 3. And I should write the full equation here. Usually, I don't think people really think about the entire equation like this, but I guess if I'm solving it for a YouTube video, then this is the most complete way to display it. All right, so here we have this matrix, dx dt equals, dx dt dy dt equals 3, negative 1, 9, negative 3. And that is multiplied by x, y, another matrix. All right, so at this point, we can begin to consider finding our eigenvalue. So last video, I said that the eigenvalue, you can just consider it to be a number. The official symbol is lambda. So let's keep that in mind as we solve for this. So a condition for solving for the eigenvalue is actually that this is true. A minus lambda times the identity matrix, where A is this matrix right there. That, when you multiply with a vector k, our eigenvector has to be equal to the zero vector. And so this is the equation we came up with last time. And another condition is basically that the determinant of this matrix, so we can do this, DET of A minus lambda I, you could also do this. Although this kind of looks like absolute value, but in linear algebra, it's determinant. I'll just do the DET function type of way. So that has to be equal to zero. And the reason for this, it's more of something related to, it's more related to like the geometric perspective of linear algebra, which I can't really do justice to right here. But basically, when you do matrix multiplication like this, what you scale this vector, but also you apply a transformation. We can forget about the scaling part, just the transformation. When you do this transformation, it keeps k on the same axis as it originally was on. You just change the length of it, right? But to do that, the determinant of a minus lambda I must be equal to the zero vector, or not just zero. So the reason for this, I guess you could think of it as kind of relating to area. So when you do the determinant, you kind of just get the area of the parallelogram formed by two vectors. And those vectors are this and that. So the two columns are your vectors that you get the area of when you make the parallelogram. So it's quite complicated to think about, but basically, if the area is zero, the determinant is zero, which means that k will be an eigenvector because it's just being scaled. Everything is collapsed into a single dimension, as Theobald and Brown would say. So that's our condition. Now, how do we do that? How do we actually solve for lambda in that situation? Well, it's quite simple. Here's what you do. So now we can write in, the vertical line format. 3, so the first entry, minus lambda, and then negative 3 on the bottom right, minus lambda. And then we have just negative 1, and then just 9. So originally we had a, which is that, and then lambda I is equal to this. So if you subtract these two, then you get this. All right. So the determinant is calculated like this. It's kind of like a fish shape. So a goldfish, you might draw it like that. So you do this times the bottom right minus this times the bottom left. So here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna multiply it out. So negative 9 and then plus lambda squared, and then the negative lambda times 3 is going to be minus 3 lambda, and then the minus 3 here and the lambda there, that will give us plus 3 lambda. So we just get nothing. And then we have to subtract by the other diagonal, the product of the other diagonal. So that product is negative 9, but if you subtract by negative 9, you get plus 9. And then the negative 9 and the 9 cancels out, or they sum to 0. Shouldn't say cancels out. And that determinant should be equal to 0. So this is our result. And if lambda squared is equal to 0, then lambda equals 0. Now, how could we have known this beforehand? Well, this vector, 3, 9, is actually on the same line as negative 1, negative 3, because they're actually they're scalar multiples of each other. So it's natural for them to be pointing in, on the same line. They're on the same axis. It would kind of be like 3 over 9 up. So they would on be on this line with slope 3, slope 3x, y equals 3x. So they'd both be on that line, which means that if you take the determinant, the area of that parallelogram is actually equal to 0. And I just remembered there's a really great geometric demonstration of the determinant. I could do that in this video, but it would take up some time. So let's just continue with this. I think I'll do that determinant thing in the future. All right, so we know that lambda equals 0 now, and we can proceed with our solving the matrix. So since lambda is 0, we can now write this augmented matrix. So we get 3 minus 0 minus 1, 9 minus 3 minus 0. Okay, and that should be like that. All right. So Basically, we just have our a minus lambda I, also known as minus zero I, and then that is supposed to be zero, the zero vector. Right. So at this point, we can kind of just do our Gaussian elimination. So what I would do first is I would multiply 3 of the first row and then subtract from the second row by that amount. And we would get this. 3, negative 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. And we get that as our outcome. So now we can solve for basically the entries of K by doing this. So we have 3 K1 minus K2 that equals 0. And of course, with the bottom row, it's just 0, 0, 0. So 0 K1 plus 0 K2 equals 0. K1, K2 could be anything. And also K1 and K2. Those are the entries of our eigenvector. All right. So, all right. I think I should explain why we have an augmented matrix. That's kind of tough, though. Let's see. Okay, so if you guys know how to solve, like for example, A, B, C, D times some vector, let's call it x, y, equals, I don't know, 1, 2. So in this situation, you actually just have a system of equations. You have, AX plus BY equals 1, and you have CX plus DY equals 2. So in this situation, if you do Gaussian elimination with AB1 as the first row, and then CD2 as the second row of your augmented matrix, you will get the values for X and Y. Now for our case, we have zeros on the bottom, which means that this is a dependent system, or one of the equations is a sum or multiple of the other rows. So there's going to be infinitely many solutions, but they have to follow this rule. And in this case, we had a minus lambda I. That was our matrix multiplied on the left, multiplied by K, which is K1, K2, equals 0, 0 across the board. All right, so we can do Gaussian elimination to basically get our outcome. And now I don't turn the first row into 1, and the reason is because we don't really have to. It would actually make things a little bit more complicated because you'd introduce a 1 over 3. So there's really no need for that. So we just have our conditional here, 3k1 minus k2 equals 0. And there are many choices here that you could do. Personally, I would do k1 equals 1. K2 equals 3. So our K matrix or vector would be equal to 1, 3. Right. Now, the problem here is that you have a homogeneous system of differential equations with a single eigenvalue. Or repeated eigenvalues with we had a double root, recall. We had x squared, or lambda squared equals zero. That means there is another, there's another vector that we have to include to actually get our final solution, x. All right, so to do that, we actually do this. We do a minus lambda I times our next vector, p, equals k. So p is another vector. It'll be the second thing that we include, and k is what we got, you know, back here. Now, this actually works because this is going to be a long explanation. All right, so in the situation where x prime, or the derivative of x, x is the solution vector containing, you know, the function for x and y equals whatever. That equals ax. Also, this is a type of system of differential equations we're solving. It's defined by this. That means, let's just say x, hypothetically, we're in the format of k times e to the lambda t. Just hypothetically, right? If we do the derivative now of this equation, implicit differentiation, I believe, we would get lambda k e lambda t. And now, then, we would get a, or, no, yes, ax equals lambda k e lambda t, where ax, x is equal to this. So we would get a k e lambda t equals lambda k e lambda t. Now, if we remove, or we divide on both sides by e lambda t, because we're allowed to do that, it's not going to be zero, because e to the lambda t will always be a value that's not zero. We will get ak equals lambda k, which is the equation for an eigenvalue slash vector. All right, now let's talk about why there's going to be a p involved. So for the situation where there's, you know, a repeated eigenvalue, a double root, let's say, we have a situation where the solution is actually this. X equals, what was it? C1, well, let's just say this. No, I have to do the C1. The general solution is this. Plus D2. Write it down here. K T E lambda T plus P E to the lambda T. So this is actually the solution for when there's a repeated root, or there's an eigenvalue with a multiplicity of 2. I think that's the official terminology. All right. And it turns out if you do the, if you get the x prime, it actually will be what you expect it to be. But I'm not going to do that right now. So I guess I could do it. Right, x prime equals. We can just cut out the c1, c2. We imagine they're one, right? So we would get right, here we have to do the product rule. So let's just take kt as the first term. First time derivative of the second plus second time derivative of the first. And then also we have the p e lambda t. Also, right, we have x prime equals ax. That's still true. That's how we define the homogeneous linear di differential system of differential equations. So at this point, we can try to compare, well, what if we did a on the left of x? That equals. Man, this is gonna be annoying. Okay, so we had originally, let's just do this. A lambda, right, k e lambda t. And then we had k t e lambda t. So a k t e lambda k. And of course, we have our last term, A, and then P, E lambda T. Now we have to subtract both of them, or no, we just have to set them equal. But it turns out we do some subtraction along the way. So we would get, let's just delete E lambda T from everything first. That would make things easier. All right, so we get, let's do the t term first. So we get t a k minus lambda k, and then let's do this and that. So we'd get AK minus lambda K. And then we could do AP minus lambda P. Add that on. And that should be equal to 0. Very nice. So here, this is starting to look a lot like. Looking a lot like, what's it called? The eigenvalue system of equations. Oh no, not the system of equations. My brain is so fried right now. Starting to think I did too much math. Oh, there was a K here too. Okay. So there was a k, and then it's actually a minus k. So everything here has to add up to 0. We know that a k lambda k, that's going to be 0, the 0 vector essentially. But then we have this new term, a p minus lambda p. Oh, yeah, I'm gonna just erase everything. So it's AP minus lambda P minus K equals 0. Okay. AP minus lambda P e minus k at the front equals 0. And we can move this minus k to the other side. We get ap minus lambda p equals k. And now we can do our thing. This is an I. Now we solve this system of equations for p from what we had as k. And we can do everything we wanted. By the way, the original equation was, if you have a multiplicity of 2 on your root for lambda, then there's going to be this format of the solution. Right. Yeah, okay, so x equals kc1 There we go. So this is our, you know, final product. So let's go find p again. And to get p, we have our a minus lambda I, p on the right, equals k. And our augmented matrix, I can't teach that right now. Okay, essentially, augmented matrix is like if you had a system of equation and you tried to solve for each variable through elimination, let's just say. So first you would eliminate all the things that are not the first variable, and then you would eliminate everything that's not the second variable, and then the third, the fourth, the fifth. From each equation down. Okay, this is too confusing to explain with just words. So I'll just continue the problem, assuming you know how to do it. So it's a minus 0i, and then we have the k vector on the right. And this is going to be 3 minus 1, 9, minus 3. I shouldn't say minus, negative 1, negative 3. And then on the right, we have 1, 3 from here. Now, this is still a dependent system of equations. The only difference is that on the right, we don't have 0. All right, so we might as well cross those out. We get 3, negative 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. All right, so to solve for this one, you do the same thing. 3, and you can imagine there was a the p1, p2 vector multiplied on the right here. So we have 3p1 minus p2 equals 1. Now you can do this however you like, but since there's no 0 here, we can actually just pretend that one of the variables is 0 and that the other variable is something that fulfills the condition. You can do this for 3 variables as well. You can just say, well, the two of these are going to be 0, and then the last one's going to be not 0. And the reason why you can't just have them both be 0 in the situation where you are actually solving for the vector k is because the 0 vector does not count as an eigenvector. So that's why. All right, now we have, let's just say that p1 is 0, and therefore p2 is negative 1. So p equals 0, negative 1. Now we can write our solution. I need to delete all of this. Actually, we can keep the top left. All right, so x equals. Also, x is an interesting choice for the vector name, the solution vector name, because, well, you know, x is what you solve for in like algebra 1 and stuff, and then for other differential equations, you're trying to solve for a value of y, but now you've gone back to solving for x, and I think some people think that might find it confusing. So, the use of x here, it kind of seems like an interesting notation. All right, anyway, x equals c1 k, which is 1, 3, e to the 0 t, also known as 1, plus c2. And then we need square brackets. And then we have still k and then 0. Or I mean 1. It's e to the 0 t again. Or there's actually a t here. Right, because we had kt e lambda t for the c2 stuff. Alright, now add on the final touches. 0 minus 1. Boom. That is our answer.